Mark Holland is originally from Statesville, North Carolina, and received his bachelor's degree in history from the University of North Carolina at Asheville in 2006. Since 2010, he's been employed with the Government Records Section of the North Carolina Department of Cultural Resources. I think they've changed their name recently. But first as a clerk, and then as a records analyst, and finally in his current position as a supervisor for records analysis, for the records analysis unit. As a supervisor, he's responsible for overseeing and administering the records management program for state and local agencies. He also directs the records analysis work of six analysts whose primary responsibility is to provide records management services to the state and local officials by consulting on creation, maintenance, and disposition of records in all formats and media. Please welcome Mark Holland.
Told me before the presentation that her father-in-law used to teach at my high school, and he taught me world history when I was a sophomore in high school. So he's indirectly responsible for me being where I am today because of my interest in history. This put me on this career path. So it's interesting. Mr. Silas Harris, he was a great instructor at West Idaho for many years. Do we have anybody from Statesville, Idaho County area? Or most everybody from Catawba County area? Anybody further out west? Around Asheville? Oh, okay. So we come from that's pretty decent drive. I love Hickory. It's like a second home to me. I grew up in Statesville. I have many friends that still live in Hickory. Friends that live in Granite Falls, if anybody's from up in that direction. I still go there 4 or 5 times a year. It's a great area. I love it. Today, I'm going to be presenting a workshop on managing public records. Some of the topics we'll be covering today will be managing public records in any and all formats, as including paper and electronic. We'll also be discussing a little bit on how to organize those paper and electronic records. So let me make sure I have this clicker available. So. See, now I already have to go back. That was one of the... Okay, here's some key points we want you to be able to take away from today's workshop. Do I sound okay on the microphone? It sounds kind of staticky. I may do away with it if it's...
Can everybody hear me okay right now?
Yes.
Okay, great. I might go do away with the microphone, man, because it's giving me a robotic head in the voice. So. Here's some key points we want you to be able to take away from today's workshop. First, we're going to provide an overview on records management and discuss some records management terms. Secondly, we want you to become familiar with the public records law, and we're going to discuss some aspects of the public records law which give you a sense of your legal responsibilities. Thirdly, we'll walk you through a records retention schedule and discuss how you can use those records retention schedules to manage your records. We'll also discuss how to organize your paper and digital files, including email, and finally we'll discuss the challenges of digital and electronic records and email and give you some tools to manage those specific challenges. Hopefully all these things will enable you to become more efficient, whether that's in the course of your daily business or in response to any public records request you may receive. Also, I should mention that I provided you with a handout. The handout isn't an exact replica of the workshop. We used to print out notes pages with workshop with the slides, but it turns out the text was too small. So we decided to save some trees and just put all the main points and the main sources of information, the most important sources of information for you on these handouts. Additionally, they're also at the bottom of the page. You'll see these different colored chevrons. If you can see them, some of you may be sitting too far back to be able to read them, but. This will be tracking the workshop as we go along and let you know which particular subject we're discussing at that moment. Now, records management analysts. What do we do as records management analysts? Records management analysts work with records custodians from state and local government to ensure compliance with the public records law. If you have records management questions or concerns, please call us for assistance. I will provide some contact information for my unit at the end of the workshop. Most of you seem to be from the western part of the state. There's a specific contact for the western part of the state. His name is Jason Wolf. I'll provide you with his contact information at the end of the workshop, and he handles everything in North Carolina West by 77. That's the sort of the borderline for him. So most of you will be, if you have questions or need want him to take a visit to maybe do to help assist you in records inventory, he's your point of contact person. Secondly, we are an assisting agency. That's why we conduct workshops such as the one I'm giving right now. So please don't think of us as any type of public records law enforcers or the records police or anything like that. We are here as a resource to consult you, to consult the state, to consult municipalities and counties with records management concerns. So what is records management? Records management is the practice of managing records throughout their life cycle, from the time they are created to their eventual disposal or destruction. These represent some of the organizations that publish guidelines and standards by which we derive our policies and recommendations. We have NAGARA, we have ARMA, we have the International Institute of Municipal Clerks, we have the National Archives. This is just a sampling of some of those institutes that assist us in deriving our policies and recommendations. Now, so when we talk about records management, it's important to distinguish between documents and records. An office may create or receive many documents, but not all of these documents can be considered a record, as illustrated by the circle diagram here. A record captures an organization's activities and is basically evidence of what an organization does. An organization being either a municipality, a county, or different entities within a municipality or a county. Now, depending on the value of the record, some may be saved and preserved permanently. But honestly, only about 3-5% of records will be saved as permanent records. 95 to 97% of records will at some point be destroyed. Now, to go into a little bit more specificity about what the difference between a document and a record is, let's just say we have a memo, a report, we could have some photographs. All of those different pieces are the documents that make up the file or make up the record as a whole. Does that make sense to everybody? Good. Now, with that in mind, let's take a look at how you can distinguish between documents and records. One way to do that is to consider the value of the record. Now, we have four different types of values of records here that we're going to discuss. The first in the top left in the green box is the administrative records. Administrative records support the routine management of your organization. Most administrative records, such as meeting agendas, notices that go around the office, or reference records like that office supply catalogs would have a short lifespan. Excuse me, that's a weird awkward sentence. In the second box here, in the red box on the top right, we have fiscal records. Fiscal records document financial authorizations, obligations and transactions, and are often subject to audit. We insert audit hold language into records retention schedules as a reminder not to destroy records not to destroy files if an audit is pending against those records. Once audits have been resolved, fiscal records often lose their value rapidly. Now, when I say we insert that language into the retention schedule, if you have an item or if you have a record series within the retention schedule and it could be subject to audits at some point in the future, we make sure to mention that you need to ensure that there is no potential for audits or no ongoing or no current audits with the record, involved with the records at that time before you destroy them. Now, in the bottom right-hand corner, we have legal records in the orange box. Legal records provide for defense in litigation, demonstrate compliance with laws and regulations, or meet other legal needs. Records with legal value are often subject to official actions, such as subpoenas, investigations, and lawsuits. We will also use litigation hold language to ensure legal records are preserved, just as we use that audit hold language for fiscal records. And just as you shouldn't destroy records if you believe there might be an audit, you should also not destroy records if you believe there might be, if you hear about a lawsuit, a potential lawsuit being filed against your office, even if those records have met their scheduled retention period. So even if it says you can destroy them after 3 years, if there's even a hint that there's going to be some type of legal action taken against those records, you cannot destroy them. Once that legal action is finished and done with, and any issues or resolutions involved with that legal action is completed, then you may destroy the records. Finally, in the bottom left-hand corner, we have in the purple box, we have historical records. Records with historical value often document significant actions or events and have enduring value. These records may also reflect decisions about significant actions or events which occurred in your municipality or your county. And also, I should interject here, if anybody has any questions about anything at all, just please feel free to interrupt at any time. I'm a very informal presenter. I like discussion, so if anybody has any questions or any comments they'd like to make at any time, just raise your hand and we can talk. We'll wait till the end.
Can I ask you about the legal side?
Sure.
Even if you believe you might be a legal action, I mean, how much does that expose us as far as that goes? I heard before that, you pretty much stick to the retention of policy, and then once that policy's fulfilled, you just get rid of the record. But this kind of throws things into a little bit different realm here.
Well, I'll give you an example of Department of Environment and Natural Resources. Let's just say they have all these coal ash records.
Okay.
Some of these records may have met their disposition, but because they know that there's so much legal ramifications involved with these records, they know that the Department of Environmental Quality needs to hold on to these records because there's so much legal action going on involving coal ash and the controversy surrounding that particular subject.
Gotcha.
If there's even a hint of legal action, it's best to err on the side of caution and to wait until that legal action is passed or the threat of that legal action is passed before you destroy those records. Because that's the worst thing to destroy. You have to destroy those records, and then somebody come back and say, well, the reason you destroyed these records was because we were going to take some kind of legal action, or we were going to engage in an audit, and you destroyed these records to avoid that legal action or the audit. So it's best to... We just advise to err on the side of caution when it comes to that.
So, if you come up with a resolution and a judgment for final determination, mm-hmm. and the record is result of that decision, then we have X amount of time before you destroy the record for that.
If they met their retention. So let's say if after that legal action is resolved, they still have a year left on their retention, you need to keep it for that extra year. But if they had already met that during that legal action or before that legal action, they had met their retention period, then you may destroy it. Does that make sense? Essential records. Now that we've discussed the different value of records, we will look at some specific types of records. And also, now that you've decided to get what you want to get a handle on your records, you want to start by conducting an inventory to get a proper accounting of what you have. An important step to take when doing an inventory is identifying the essential records which may exist in your office. Now, when emergency strikes, records are critically important. Essential records provide the agency or the municipality or the county with the information it needs to conduct business under abnormal conditions and to resume more normal business after an event occurs. These records allow the agency to continue functioning under a range of adverse conditions, whatever their intensity or duration. Essential records can be found in any format, digital, paper, any type of format. Records are considered essential to your agency when they, and I'm going to list several different examples of essential records. Essential records are necessary for emergency response, such as disaster plans or blueprints. They are necessary to resume or continue operations, such as personnel records or payroll. They are used to preserve legal, financial, and functional status. These records may include board minutes, financial statements, agreements, contracts, budgets, grants, election records, etc. They can also be considered essential records if they protect the health, safety, property, and rights of the citizens of your municipality or county, or the state of North Carolina if you're a state agency. So these are records such as licenses, tax records, permits, property records, things of that nature. They are also considered essential records if they would require massive resources such as time or money to reconstruct. And finally, they can also be considered essential records if they document the history of communities and families. These are records that may possess permanent value such as charters, artifacts, minutes of board meetings, things of that nature. Now, those are the criteria that you will use when deciding which of your records are essential. Once you have decided the essential records, Once you have decided on which records in your office are essential, you should assess the risks of these records and take steps necessary to prioritize and protect these essential records. Risk management. Risk management is the entire process of assessing risks, evaluating risks, and then deciding on priorities for actions and informing the county or municipality so that resources are available and actions can be taken to manage that risk. What we are doing in risk management for essential records entails developing a strategy to manage the risks by identifying and evaluating protection strategies appropriate for these essential records. Examples of risk management include storing records in waterproof cabinets, inspecting pipes annually, relocating records stored in risky environments, etc., etc. If you need assistance, we are always available to come out and help you with this. So like I said, the western part of the state, Jason Wolf's your contact person. If you can't get a hold of Jason for whatever reason, feel free to contact me, or since you'll be familiar with me after this workshop, feel free to make your initial contact with me, and then I may arrange something with Jason. We may be able to come out, we should be able to come out there and take a visit. Now, I'm just going to give you a couple examples of risk management. I can't remember what county it is, but I wouldn't put them out there in front of everybody anyway. There was a particular county whose sheriff's office, they stored their records in a trailer outside in the back of their, I think it was a town hall or something like that, back in one of their county buildings. These records were, they were locked in a trailer and there were no temperature controls within the trailer. There were leaks within the trailer where water would come down and they would contaminate the records. And once they decided they wanted to go in there and destroy these records, they found that the records had become so moldy and so hazardous that they could not access these records for fear that their employees would become ill. So they had to call in the people in the biohazard suits, the full suits, to come in there and clean all, go through all the records. They had to go through there to make sure they didn't have anything in there that they needed to keep as well. So they needed to go through there and they needed to clean the records as best they could. And even if they were to destroy them, they can't just take them and just start, destroying them if they have hazardous materials with them. They have to dispose of them in a certain way. I'll give you another example of an interesting situation. We had somebody else storing them in a trailer, which was a little more waterproof. This was a state agency, I believe. It was more weatherproof. They didn't have to worry about rain or snow or melting snow coming into the trailers or anything of that nature. But they had to worry about insects and spiders. When some of our guys went to go pick these records up, there were spiders all over some of the records. I'm not sure, some of you might not like spiders that much, but these guys, they didn't like them. So they said, you need to clean all the insects and all the bugs and all the vermin out of here. The mice can also be a problem. Mice, they go into the boxes, they make nests in the boxes. So you have to make sure you store them in a place and make sure wherever you store those records is not open to the weather or to any other outside interference such as vermin or insects or bugs or things of that nature. But you're probably not going to be storing your essential records your board minutes in a trailer in the back of the town hall though, so I digress. Non-record materials. Now, as we determined earlier, not all documents can be considered records. A record is a document consciously retained as evidence of action. The types of records listed here may be destroyed or otherwise disposed of when their reference value ends. And we'll go into reference value or administrative value, as you'll see it sometimes, a little bit later on in the workshop. However, and keeping in mind, all public employees should be familiar with specific records retention and disposition schedules, as well as applicable guidelines for your office and the public records law, which is included on your handout there. Now, when in doubt about whether or not a record has short-term value, or whether it has special significance or importance, retain that record in question until you can get clarification or retention by contacting one of us at the Record Center in Raleigh. Oops. Authentic records. An authentic record is one that has the properties and attributes of being genuine. A record that is precisely what it claims to be. This is where a good record-keeping policy will help to establish the creation and maintenance of your records and establish audit trails for admissibility in court. So authenticity is established not only by attributes of the document itself, but also by a common set of business practices which govern the management of these records. Now, we'll go into some of these policies later on in the presentation. Confidential records. Is anyone familiar with sunshine laws? Sunshine laws are basically laws and regulations requiring openness in government. North Carolina is one of the most open sunshine law states in the nation, and the North Carolina Public Records Law assumes that any public record is, in essence, public information and open to inspection unless it is specifically identified as otherwise by a federal or a state statute. If you tell someone that they cannot see a record because it is confidential, be prepared. You need to be prepared to cite the federal or state law that makes it so. Now, there are basically two types of confidential records. One is the type that cannot be released at all, such as medical records, personally identifying information like social security numbers, driver's license, things of that nature. The second type of confidential record is the kind that is not accessible, but optional, like blueprints. Again, if you tell someone that they cannot see a record because it is confidential, be prepared to cite the applicable federal statute or state law. You will want to review that law carefully because sometimes confidential information means only certain people can see the records in particular situations. For example, parts of a personnel file may come under review during a grievance proceeding. Additionally, there are parts of personnel files that are open to the public. For example, you can go online, you can find my name, you can find how much I made, you can find my age, you can find several different pieces of information from my personnel file. You cannot go in there and get my social security number, get my beacon identification number, or any of that identifying type of information from my personnel file. But there are certain parts of the personnel file which are open to the public. In short, there's a difference between a public record and public information. Just because a citizen or even say a reporter says, but this is a public record, I need to see it, that does not necessarily mean that it's public information. On the other hand, just because someone stamps a memo or stamps an email as being private in nature does not make that email confidential or private. Also, additionally, if a public record has confidential information, you would still have to provide access to the record. You just need to redact the confidential information from that record. And if you need assistance with doing any of that, please feel free to contact us. And as I'll continue to say, the contact information is at the end of the workshop. I believe there is a contact information is on the handouts as well, on the very back of the last page. So I'll quit repeating myself and saying and mentioning that the contact information is at the end of the workshop, but it's on the handout. Also, a helpful reminder for municipal schedules and county schedules. We do list citations if a particular record is confidential. We list it out on the side. There's a column there. Once we go over the workshops, or once we go over the schedules in more detail, I will point it out to you. There's an entire column dedicated to giving you information concerning whether or not particular records are confidential or in nature. Now, let's conclude our overview of records management by discussing some of the benefits of managing your records. Active management helps to control your records growth, so you will have less to manage, which can lead to cost savings on storage facilities, equipment, as well as supplies. You'll have improved office efficiency because things will be easier to find, and you'll also be able to protect your essential records so that if the unthinkable happens, such as disasters, the tornado, things of that nature, you will be able to have quick recovery for business and customer service to continue that. Additionally, you will also be able to easily and quickly comply with any legal requirements that you may need to comply with. General Statute 121. Chapter 121 is the Archives and History Act. This act describes many of the duties and responsibilities of the Department of Natural and Cultural Resources. Here are just a few of the important points in Chapter 121. Whoops. What Chapter 121 does, if you look at the first sentence under Provision 2 there, is to assign records management responsibility to the Department of Natural and Cultural Resources. We are the individuals within the state who are assigned that responsibility by the government, by the state of North Carolina, to assist you in records management, which is pointed out here at the end of that paragraph, where it says, where it says the state of North Carolina authorizes our department to assist with the maintenance and the preservation of public records. Sorry, I thought I had this as an interactive one that would blow up the particular language, but I don't. And finally, this act, General Statute 121, also establishes the state archives. Now, state archives is where we will take a lot of your older courthouse records, things of that nature. We have, and I will give you the contact person if you have old courthouse records, or if you know somebody who has some old records and they don't know what to do with them, feel free to contact us. And Kina Herzinger, if you see her name on the contact list, she is the point person. She can be a point person for if you have any old records, or such as courthouse records, old civil dockets, criminal dockets, things of that nature. If you're not sure what to do with some of those old records, you contact her and we will work out. Maybe we can come down there and inspect those records. We may bring them into the state archives. State archives also takes into records that have historical value from state agencies. Now, moving on to General Statute. Let's see, now my mouse is not going to work.
Is that mouse working?
Let me go see if it works.
Does it make matter?
It looks like the light's still coming on. Maybe I just need
to. I'll stay after a while.
Okay. Yeah, they have to stand up here and say slide, slide, slide. But the clicker's not really wanting to cooperate, so. Moving on to General Statute 132. General Statute 132 is also known as the Public Records Law. This statute defines what public records actually are. It also lays out in detail the duties of the government records section, my section, in conducting records management and ensuring access to public records. GS 132 defines public records and your responsibilities as the custodians of these records. GS 132 identifies any materials, regardless of the physical forms or characteristics, so that means paper or digital. It can also mean even crazy things like bricks. I'll give you an example here. When they were constructing the executive mansion, the governor's mansion in Raleigh, they had the people who were constructing the building, they would mark certain bricks as like progress of their construction of the sidewalk around the building. And technically, that could be considered a public record. So anything that documents the work of the state or the local governments. So yes, you mean a brick. So a public record in essence is any document, voicemail, data record, email, or brick that documents the business of that government. It does not matter who paid for these materials or what sort of media the record is composed of. What matters is that these examples document a transaction of public business. That's the most important part. The consent that the Department of Natural and Cultural Resources gives for the destruction of certain records is the record retention schedule, which I will show you here in just a few slides. Please keep in mind that if a record is not listed in the schedule, then you cannot destroy it until you receive permission, and there is a procedure to add records to the schedule to receive permission to destroy them. We also have procedures for a one-time permission amendment. So I'll give you an example. If you come upon some records that your office just no longer creates, and they stopped creating them about 30 years ago, you can talk to us, and we will be able to provide you with a form that you can fill out for a one-time destruction of records. We don't have to add something to the schedule that hasn't been used in 30 years just so you can destroy these records. However, if you have some records that you are currently and are created in an ongoing basis, those are the types of records that you are going to need to contact us so that we can put them on the retention schedule for you. Also, if there are records which you may not be sure of whether or not they're on the retention schedule, you can also contact us in the event that happens, and we will assist you in maybe clarifying certain descriptions of certain record series and see if we can fit those records into those record series and apply them to them. to the dis, to those specific dispositions. Now, we keep in mind that we often describe records in a general way on a schedule. So if you can't find a specific record on the retention schedule, well, like I said, just try and think of how that record might be categorized, and if you have difficulty there, feel free to contact us. Oh, there we go, mouse word. Now, the general public has the right to inspect public records, as I said earlier. GS-132-6 reads, every custodian of public records shall permit any record in the custodian's custody to inspect it, to be inspected and examined at reasonable times and under reasonable supervision by any person, and shall, as promptly as possible, furnish copies thereof upon payment of any fees as may be prescribed by law. So, some things you should know is that no person requesting to inspect and examine public records or to obtain copies thereof shall be required to disclose the purpose or motive for the request. If knowing why someone wants to see certain records will help you provide them with what they want, you're more than free to ask, but keep in mind that you cannot require them to tell you why they want to see the records and use that as a reason to deny them access to those records. But basically, you can ask them, but they don't have to tell you. But you still have to provide them with those records unless there's some sort of federal or state law that prohibits you, that prohibits them from inspecting. Now, you cannot really charge to fill a public record request. GS-132 discusses what a public office can charge to provide access to these records. David Lawrence, he wrote a book on managing public records that we reference quite often. He's stopped updating it. He's retired. He's a professor at the UNC School of Government. But basically, he says you can charge for toner, you can charge for the cost of paper, you can charge for the cost of a CD or a DVD, etc. You may also be wondering if your particular office or agency needs to charge for the cost of personnel time spent answering the public records requests. Generally, we say no, unfortunately. Offices can only charge for the actual cost of reproducing the record. Yours, your time, and my time in providing the public with those records, that's a given. We cannot really charge for time spent on pulling these records, only for the actual cost of duplicating the paper, the DVD, or the CD, etc. Now, lastly, you must provide it in the medium requested. If someone asks me to provide it to you with color transparencies, in an extreme example like that, I would have to decline. Our office does not have the capability to adequately prepare color transparencies to provide them. But if they were to ask for it in a digital format, or if they were to ask for it in a paper format, we would have to provide it because we are more than ready to provide to, you know, print it on a piece of paper or take a file and put it on a CD or a DVD to get to them. Now, but additionally, if I were asked for PDFs of all my email, even though my email is not in a PDF format, I have Adobe Pro and I have all my emails on the same machine. So, because I have the capability to do so, I would be able to combine all those emails into a PDF as the citizen or as the requester requesting. Yes?
Does that get into the time spent to do that? That's not a normal routine?
No, it's, like I said, we can't really charge. There's no set rate that we can charge. See, for example, the federal government charges, I think it's $28 per hour for the Department of Justice, at least. I don't know about other federal departments. They charge $28 per hour to search for public records. But we don't have that. We don't have the ability to do that. There's no outstanding fee that's laid out on a state or a local level for us to say, yes, we charge X amount of dollars for searching or gathering the records, for requests. We can only charge them for the actual cost of reproducing those records.
But in that case, would you have the ability to negotiate? So in other words, you do have the ability to say, when you do PDF email, you know, if you had a different format, you would at least be able to propose that as an offer.
To propose it as an offer for charging for time, or
decrease time that it would take to produce it.
If it's, you always have the option of saying, say if they want to have it in a paper format, you always have the option of saying it's going to save you time and money if you just buy a $2 CD And it's going to save us from having to go in there and just stand at the copy machine while 1,000 pages gets printed, when you can just put that into a PDF and email it to them free of charge, or put it on a disc and charge, you know, $2 or however much it costs to reproduce a CD or a DVD, as opposed to charging, you know, 10 cents per paper, which is what a lot of offices charge, 10 cents per piece of paper. So you have the option of giving them different options to reduce their costs and reduce the time it takes for you to provide that record. Seems like it's kind of working again, but now, how many of you have been to our website before? Good, that's a couple of people, better than mine. Our website's URL has been, it's sort of had an identity crisis for the past year or so. This is what it is currently. I'm not going to promise that this is what it's going to be a year from now. I'm not going to promise that this is going to be what it is a week from now. But this is what it is right now, and this is where you can go to get access to your retention schedules, be it a municipality or a county. And I'm going to walk you through how to access your retention schedule. So basically, the retention schedule, I mentioned it a few times, but basically the retention schedule is a document that identifies and describes your office's records and provides instructions for their disposition. Now, here's how you navigate it. I'm going to walk you through how to navigate it to it from a website. Whoops. So you see this, you see the little yellow, you see the different colored tabs here. The yellow tab is the one that you want. You are employees of the government, be it state or local. You'll click on the For Government tab. And this may be helpful to write this down. This is probably one of the few things I'll say you definitely need to write this down. This you will access, as I said, our website, archives@ncdcr.gov, you'll access the For Government tab. That's the yellow tab. Remember anything at all, just remember yellow. There's an option within the yellow box, and I thought I had an interactive slide here, but it's not being cooperative for whatever reason. Normally the page follows it, it goes down and clicks on it. But at the end, if we have enough time, I may go in there and I may navigate manually to the site and show you that. That may be the easiest way. But I'll go ahead and walk you through it now. You'll go, and there's an option to click on retention schedules. It's pretty simple. Then it'll give you, it'll take you to another page, and you have an option for three more schedules. You want to click on the, make sure you click on the local, on the local tab. And once you click on the local tab, it'll list all the schedules for local governments. There's only one schedule for municipalities. If you are an employee of a municipality, you only need to access that one schedule. There are several different schedules for different county offices. We have, you know, sheriff's office. We have a county management schedule for that central management of the county. We also have, you know, a library schedule, DSS schedule, health department schedule, several different schedules for the county. But remember, the municipality schedule, there's only one schedule. But all those schedules will be listed in a table. In the left column will be the schedule. In the right column are amendments to that schedule that we have added after the original approval of that schedule. Now typically, these are things where we'll go in there where a federal or a state law has been passed that may affect the retention period of some of those items within that, one or more of the items within that schedule. So we'll do an amendment, which isn't an overall change of anything within the schedule, but it's a change to just one item within that schedule. And we'll add those in the right column. Now, once you click on one of these schedules, and I'll go ahead and go to the next page so you can see what I'm talking about. Once you click on one of these schedules, this is the format that these schedules will be in. Now you see on the left side here, actually I should point out in the shaded bar at the top here, there are different standards that are going to be within your schedule. So, for example, this is the regional council schedule. The different standards represent different areas of the regional council schedule. For example, this is the community and economic development section of that regional council schedule. Now, typically, we have a table of contents at the beginning of the document, beginning of the PDF, that you can click on a standard, and it will take you directly to that standard.
So once you go there, you'll find that we have an item number here. This is mainly for reference. Say, if you come, if you call us or if you send us an email and you say, well, I need to know what to do with, let's just use one of these as an example. I need to know what to do with Certified Development Corporation records. I say, well, you can access the regional council schedule and it'll be under standard 9, item number 3. That'll be your key to look in that schedule to find that particular record. If I just give you the name, oh, well, that's under Certified Development Corporation records in the regional council schedule, you won't really know what I'm talking about unless you go through there and eyeball the entire document. Giving you that standard and giving you that item number will make it much easier for you to find the records that you need. Now, in the second column here is the record series title. That is the name of the records in question. There's also a brief description that goes along with that title. The description gives you different types of documents which may make up that, or different types of documents or files that may make up that record. Your office may produce some or all of these files or documents within this record. This is also where some clarification issues may arise. If you don't see something and you think it may, if you don't see a particular file or document and you think it may fall under one of these, feel free to give us a call and we can provide you some clarification or assistance. The third column here is disposition instructions. This gives you instructions on what you can do with these records. As I said, 97% of them can be destroyed. So you'll see all three of these here. We can destroy these at some time. Now you do see this on A here. This one does say retain records with historical value permanently. That's really up to your office, and that's if you need clarification or assistance in that matter, you can call us and we'll guide you and we'll give you some advice on typical records that have historical value within that particular record series. And so if you have any, if you need clarification on what may or may not be considered a record with historical value, contact us. Now finally, over in the far right column is the citation column. None of these particular records have any citations or governments or federal or state citations associated with them. So if one does, this is where we will put it. We will put it here if a federal or state citation provides required by law disposition for any of these records. So let's just say that let's just say this one's destroying office 5 years. So if there was a federal law or a state law that requires that record be kept 5 years, this is where we would put it here. So if you have any, if there's any sort of dispute over why I need to keep these records for 5 years, that's why we provided, where applicable, a statute over here that you can access. Additionally, we also provide federal or state citations for those records which are deemed confidential on a federal or state level. So if you are not sure of whether or not you can provide a particular record in a public records request, just check that far right column and see if there's some type of confidentiality citation denoting it as confidential or something to be withheld from the public inspection. Also, if you believe that you have records, a record series that has confidential information in it, you don't see a confidentiality citation there, please let us know and we'll inspect that particular record series and determine whether we need to include that citation on a future update of that particular record series. Does anybody have any questions on the record retention schedule? I know I cut through it for the sake of time pretty briefly. Does anybody have any questions on the retention schedules or the layout of retention schedules? Good. Have any of you ever dealt with the retention schedule for your office? Any experience dealing with retention schedules? Okay, a couple of you nodding yes. Not a very confident nod, but a nod nonetheless. Now, you also have the ability to search within these records, to search within these schedules. This is very helpful because before the days of PDF, if you just had a scan, if you just scanned a document in your computer, that was it, it was just a scan. Now with OCR, we have the ability to make PDFs text searchable. So anything in this schedule you just hit Control F and you can find, and you can search for keywords or phrases within this schedule. It'll show you all the different hits or results for that particular keyword or phrase. Say for example, you printed the schedule out, you don't have that luxury, but we do provide an index at the end of the schedule for you to reference
which is still somewhat helpful if you are searching for, say, some type of fire record and you, for emergency management section, and you type in fire, you might have 50 hits on the schedule. So you want to go to the index there, and they list the different types of fire records, all the fire records that are associated with fire inspection and things of that nature. So it makes it a lot easier. So it makes it easier in that aspect than the search. Now, in the records retention schedule, there are certain items that have a blank space for you to fill in, and it says you may destroy these records when administrative value ends, and there will be a blank spot there. That is for your office to determine an internal policy on how long you are going to keep those records. So if you see any records with destroying office when reference value ends or when administrative value ends, that is up to your office to develop an internal policy on how long you are going to keep those records and when you can destroy them. So once your office has signed off on the latest version of a particular schedule, you will need to sit down and you will need to go through there and determine the retention periods for those records which have blanks and reference administrative value or reference value. Now, typically these are records that, as it says in the definition here, the usefulness of records to support ancillary operations in the routine management of an organization. Typically these records are not historical in nature, and it's just what it says right there. They help, they assist in the routine management of an organization. So they're not records which are typically going to be longer, held longer than, say, 1 or 2 or 3 years, which is why, and it may vary from county to county. Mecklenburg County deals with a lot more records than, say, if you go to one of the, you know, go to one of the smaller counties. So they may need to provide a shorter retention period for these types of records because they have less space to work with. Or the inverse they may have more space to work with, or they may have more resources available in which to store records, so they may want to keep a longer retention period. That's why we leave it up to the county and municipality in question to fill those particular areas out with the blank space. And I'll pull up, and like I said, I'll pull up a schedule at the end, and I'll go and I'll run through it, and I'll show you an example of what one of those looks like. Triggers. What starts the clock on the retention period? So you may be wondering, if something is destroyed after 3 years, when do I start counting down for that 3 years? Different actions can trigger that retention countdown clock. For example, when something is received or entered or completed, those are all adequate triggers for counting down dispositions for particular record series. Generally, that trigger is pretty clear, but you can determine it easily. You can, like I said, repeat. I'm repeating myself ad nauseum. Please call us for clarification. Please keep retention triggers in mind when you're creating records as well. For instance, if you were having an email conversation with a colleague that you correspond with a lot, be sure to have distinct email conversations with specific subjects in the subject field. Otherwise, you'll have a 5-year-long email conversation that has never started retention. So you'd be able to pinpoint those particular subjects in each one of those emails. That way you can start the clock on them individually. Now, I mentioned earlier there's a request for, you can send a request to change items in the records retention schedule. Sometimes we do what we call local amendments. That's if, say, I'll use Mecklenburg County as another example, or Guilford County or Wake County. Some of these larger counties, they may create so many records that it becomes a burden for them to keep the records as stated in the retention period. If they can adequately prove that this is a burden on them, either financially or for storage space purposes or otherwise, they can put in a request to change the disposition for that particular record series within that amendment, but it only applies to their county or it only applies to their municipality. Now, they will have to send that request to us, and we will have to approve it before we can finalize that. So keep that in mind. Additionally, If you notice that there is a retention period that may be too short, or if there's a retention period that you think may be unnecessarily long, that's another trigger for requesting a change in that record schedule. So you could send us a request to change a particular record series from 3 years to 5 years, and you don't have to start off using the formal form or anything of that nature. You can call us and say, well, I noticed that it says keep these records for 3 years. Well, we deal with them a lot, and we think it's necessary that we may want to change this universally to be 5 years, and we think other counties and municipalities would benefit from this. We're open to those suggestions, and we'll take them in consideration when revising or updating the retention schedule in the future. Now, generally, we try to keep the retention schedules, as a general rule of thumb, we try to keep them updated within the past 10 years. If they're older than 10 years, we tend to consider that an outdated retention schedule. Some of them take a little bit more time to update than others, because some of them, such as the education schedule or the DSS schedule or health department schedule, we have to work with other agencies to create those schedules, like the Department of Public Instruction or the Health and Human Services. So it's a little longer period of time for those schedules than others. But most schedules we try to keep updated within the past 10 years, and best case scenario, within the past 5 years. Now, we also have a form for request for disposal of unscheduled records. This is what I was mentioning earlier. If you find some records that are 30 years old and they document actions or a program that was in your county and municipality which is no longer active or which you haven't created records for in 30 years, and you just want to find some way to get rid of these records, you can fill this form out. And I will say that on our website, there's a space for forms under that yellow tab that you can click on that provides you with most, if not all, of the forms that I'm going to be talking about here in the workshop. So you can find this form, you can fill it out, you can mail it to us, or you can email it to us. And you know, if you want to call us and give us some more clarification on the form, that's fine too. And we'll take it into consideration, we'll review it, and we'll either sign it and approve it, or give you a reason for our non-concurrence. Now, the fun part, records destruction. Half of records retention is making sure that these records are accessible for their entire lifespan. The other half is destroying them thoroughly once that lifespan is ended. We have many different ways to destroy records. As you can see here, you can burn records. I'm not really sure if that's practical for a lot of people, but it is part of the administrative code that you may burn records. The most common method of records destruction is recycling records. Or you can contact a vendor. For example, for the records we destroy at the government records section of the record center, we contact a vendor who will come and pick up our records, and they will take them to a recycling facility, and they will pulp these records and turn them into paper towels. When they sign that agreement, coming on as the vendor, they sign not to distribute these records, not to do anything with these records which would jeopardize the content or distribute the content of these records. They're there, they take these records confidentially and go and they pulp them and recycle them. Another option is to shred the records. You can often contact a vendor to come in, and they'll do on-site shredding for your office if you have lots of records which are eligible for destruction. They'll bring a portable shredder with them, and they'll plug it in, and they'll shred all the documents right there in your office. Now, it's important to remember that when shredding documents, especially if they have confidential information on them, you need to make sure that confidential information is completely eradicated and cannot be reproduced in any way. I've got a couple fun stories for this slide, but I'll save them until I'm done explaining all the methods of destruction. But it's important that you make sure that any vendor that comes to shred your records can cross-shred it. What I mean by that is they shred it both vertically and horizontally into very, very slim slivers, and makes it confetti, which leads to my story. I believe it was the Macy's Day Parade. They provided the city, specific guilty parties, it could have been any form of government up there, provided parade organizers, I guess, with some confetti to use within the parade. Well, unbeknownst to the organizers, this confetti, and apparently to the people that provided them with confetti, this confetti was created from shredding government documents, which included some of identifying information on them. So there were people's names, there were social security numbers that were on these, and it wasn't shredded finely enough to be able to completely eradicate this information. It's not something that we would recommend you contributing these to parades in the first place, let alone ones that were made from shredded public documents or shredded documents which may contain confidential information. So it's important to remember that you need to make sure that information, especially confidential information, is completely and utterly destroyed so that in no ways will you be able to reconstruct that record. Now, finally, the one on the right, you may be wondering what this is. These are acid baths, and yes, if you have them available, you can use them to destroy public records. And it's funny, and we always like to use it as a joke, but
In the case of those records which were contaminated by mold, that actually is the most acceptable way to destroy those records. Burning the records isn't going to be healthy for anybody. If you burn it and send all those mold spores into the air, shredding them really isn't that convenient either. So what they'll do a lot of times, there have been a couple instances where people will come because the records are in such bad condition, they will have people come and they will put those biohazard suits on, they'll just throw them in a vat of acid and dissolve the records. But if it gets to that point, you got bigger problems than trying to figure out how you're going to destroy your records. So. Now, destruction of records also includes the destruction of digital or electronic files. Now, in July of 2014, State Archives of North Carolina updated our section of North Carolina Administrative Code to explicitly incorporate electronic records. Now, as you may know, deleting a file isn't enough to completely erase it from your computer. All that does is give the computer permission to overwrite that information when it feels like it. To destroy an electronic record, the actual data associated with the record needs to be overwritten. Keep in mind as well that multiple copies of the same record may exist on different computers. You need to make sure all those copies are destroyed if the retention period is met. Just to go into a little more specific detail on why deleting just doesn't work. For example, if you take a particular photograph and you save it on your computer, let's just say you save it as 01. You take, later on you decide, I don't want that photograph anymore. You take it and you drag it, you put it in a recycling bin, and you even empty the recycling bin. You think it's gone, right? Well, if you were to go save a completely different photo or name a completely different photo as 01, and you go into the Windows Explorer window where that picture is, and you click on that picture without opening it, the little thumbnail that comes to the right will be of your old 01 picture. Because the computer still saves that picture somewhere in its memory, you just haven't given that permission to overwrite that file yet. It's still that particular file is still deep within the recesses of the computer. So you may hear some people use the term computer forensics or forensic. That's what computer forensics. That's the idea that people in the law field can go into a computer and they can find records or they can find evidence where the user or the owner of that computer does not think it exists. So it's very important that you consult, if not your IT department, consult people that specialize in wiping hard drives to make sure that all that information is completely eradicated from the hard drive, particularly if it's confidential. Yes?
Speaking of that, that's my question, not to ask. If the custodian of the record released an email and the information systems department has mail archiving, the custodian has said they purged the record, but we may retain the mail archive. How is that handled?
You're still considered the custodian of the record. IT or whoever is housing that email archive is only the manager of that record. You are still responsible for going to them and saying, hey, I have these records here, or hey, I have these particular emails which are archived with you. I need you to remove them from servers, from your backup servers or your storage. I'll just give you another example. This isn't digital, but it's paper, but it's along the same lines. We bring in certain state agency records and house them temporarily within our facility. These records still belong to the agency. They're still responsible for them. All we do is we house it for them. That's the same situation as a lot of IT agencies around the state. They are simply housing the backups, or they are housing the archives of those email accounts. We are still responsible for those records. They still belong to us. They are just housed differently. Just think of them as virtual warehouses for your digital files.
So if it was still housed, would it be requirement to provide that if it's been deemed by the custodian?
If there's still copies of it out there, if somebody were to request that record, if you destroy one copy of it, if there's other copies out there, you'll need to provide those. That's why it's important that you need to make sure that everything is destroyed when you destroy all copies of the record when that disposition period is met.
So the recommendation there needs to severely limit the archive.
Well, it just depends on what the subject of the email is. You will have, and we'll talk about that a little bit further too, but if certain emails require long-term attention, certain emails dealing with certain subjects require longer-term attention, Those are the emails that you will need to flag, and you know, the shorter term emails you can flag them for being, you know, you can work with your IT department to flag them and say, well, these emails, we're only going to need to keep these particular ones for 2 years. And that goes into organizing your email account, and we'll talk about that a little bit further too. You can flag and categorize certain emails based on retention period, based on subject matter. Yes?
Is there a recommendation for the state of how long the email is? Pretty much all IT here.
Okay.
How long backups are kept? Okay. Is there a responsibility on the IT department to keep backups for a certain amount of time? Or is that just from department heads and stuff?
Now they have, there are provisions in retention schedules for, are you a municipality or a county? You were the county. There are provisions in the county schedule. There are records that refer to backup records. And some of it's maintenance of those backup records. Some of them is the actual backup record itself. So this doesn't necessarily mean that you're managing the individual records in there. This is just making sure that you keep those records, those backup records, in case something happens to the main records. That's the retention that applies to those records. The retention for listed in that description or that disposition instruction on the schedule for that backup item does not refer to those items that you have backed up within. Does that make sense? Okay. Now, also I should also mention that if you receive a public records request for a record, and that record could have already been destroyed, you can't turn around and destroy it just to prevent it from being released to the public. So say, for example, you have some records that have been sitting around in your office, you could have destroyed them a year ago, and all of a sudden a reporter wants to request these records. Well, you have to be able to provide these records because you didn't destroy them when their disposition period was met. So now, because you have them laying around, you have to provide them to the requester. You would have to provide them to that reporter. So that's why it's important to make sure that you destroy and you follow your retention schedule and destroy these records when they're due for destruction, just so long as there's no legal or audit, legal or other actions involved with those records. Now, audit and litigation holds. So just a reminder, again, if you were under litigation or the threat of litigation, that would not be a good time to start destroying records or start shoveling files into the fireplace. Even if those records, like I said, even if those records could have been destroyed years ago, you need to wait until that official action has been resolved before resuming your destruction. Now, if you have proceeded with your records destruction and are unaware of forthcoming litigation or official action, then having documentation in your policy that you do destructions once a year or once every quarter, or just documenting your destructions period, that is a good way to forestall any type of controversy that may arise from destroying records and not being able to fulfill a records request because you destroyed these records 6 months before that record was requested. You will be able to produce, a lot of times we advise, especially local municipalities and counties, to create a log and list the records they destroyed, the date that the records were destroyed. So that way, in case something does come up, you can point to that log and say, we destroyed these, and the reasoning for this destruction was based on retention schedules. You can have that log and a retention schedule and say, this is our justification for destroying these records. Now, managing information. Now, hopefully with the advent of computers, nobody's desk looks like this. Now, I have seen some desks that are pretty bad. I'm not going to name any names. In state agency, there are some desks pretty bad. Mine's only about 1/10 that height. But what we see most often, keeping everything forever, this includes paper and digital records, until space limits are reached. Now, this is what you see a lot of times, is some people may not be familiar with records retention schedule for their county or their municipality, so they just keep all these records around until all of a sudden they figure out, well, hey, we need to start getting rid of some of this stuff because we can't even work. We have whole rooms that are taken up by records. So let's call the State Record Center up, let's call Mark, and him and he and a couple of his partners will come down, and they'll help us do an inventory. We enjoy doing that, and we do it a lot, but you can prevent that entire day being taken out of your schedule if you use the records retention schedule and regularly destroy those records which are eligible for destruction. But just in case you do run into problems where you have a lot of records laying around and you're not really sure what to do with them and you're sort of overburdened with the responsibility,
you can contact us, we can come over there. Just, I've done it two or three times in the past couple months. I've gone to remote municipalities. We don't care where you are. We'll send somebody out there. If you're in the state of North Carolina, we'll send somebody out there to help you guys out. We'll come out there one day and we'll just go through entire file rooms. We'll mark this can be destroyed, this can be destroyed. You can get rid of this in 2 years. We'll mark a date on there when they can destroy it. We've cleaned out entire attics worth of buildings with just the retention schedule in hand. So we're more than happy to come and assist you guys with any destruction or any records management help that you may need. So that way your offices or your file rooms don't end up looking like this. Now, I mentioned the same thing is true for digital records. This is actually a screenshot of my desktop. No, I'm just kidding. Mine's actually a lot more than that. But there are a couple things that you need to tell yourself. There's a few things that you need to do when getting ready to organize and manage your public records. Because before you can destroy them, like I said, you need to have them organized and be able to manage them effectively before you can start destroying things and start throwing things into the shredder. Now, first step, you need to clear the deck. You need to review the paper files and the digital files in your office, destroy everything that you can, and understand what is left. If it wasn't that simple, that's why we're going to go through a few slides for each step. All right, first, you need to locate your current program records retention schedule and the general schedule for the state. Well, that's the general schedule state agency records. You need to locate your current retention schedule for your municipality or for the office that you are a part of within your county. Then, your second step is you need to physically inspect your paper and digital files and record any essential information about them and match them to your records retention schedules. If, according to the schedules, they have met their retention periods, you can destroy them by shredding, burning, or recycling using one of those options that I listed earlier, throw them an acid bag. This includes those digital records and electronic storage media such as CDs, floppy disks, etc. I know I'm running short on time, so I gotta try to finish this last half of the workshop for you. So please let me know if I'm going too fast and need me to go back and cover anything else. Now, if according to the schedules, Now, the remainder of your active and inactive files, you need to recognize those and identify which ones need to be retained and which ones can be destroyed. Now, if you find certain problems, you may run into things like locked filing cabinets, you may run into orphaned file sets, files that you don't really know where they belong to, who managed them, where they came from. You can save those for later and only concentrate on the ones that you do know and then go back to those and contact us if necessary. Inventory. An inventory is an inspection, identification of all the files in your office, both paper and digital, and recording the essential information about them, as I mentioned earlier in the previous slide. Now, you can identify these files in groups, only not individual folders or individual electronic or digital files. Now, paper-based records, they're often found in filing cabinets, found in shelves, boxes. Don't forget those records that may be stored in off-site facilities, such as off-site storage buildings. Digital files, obviously, I don't have to tell this to the IT guys, commonly stored in local hard drives, shared drives, CDs, external hard drives, remote devices, things like that. Now, there are typically three approaches to inventory. First is, for some reason my interactive slides aren't working very well. I think it may be something with my mouse doesn't like my interactive, the clicker doesn't like my interactive version. Interactive workshop slides, but the first approach is a physical inventory. The project leader or members of this project team review all the paper and digital records, and using a records inventory form, which we'll inspect in the next two slides, they will collect basic descriptive information. Now, these team members focus on their work areas, but they can also focus on other records or other areas that are familiar to them. Now, you may walk into offices and storage spaces, opening file cabinets and boxes just to see what's in there and see if you can just get a physical inventory on those records, whether they belong to you or not, just getting them to their proper owner. They may be that a certain office had that, or a certain area of the county government had that office before you, and they moved on to another building. You can now take those records and give them to the proper home. Now, the second step is to take a physical survey. Now, this is usually done by professionally trained records analysts and consultants. That's us.
We will collect very detailed information, and we will often provide you with assistance on whether or not you can store certain records. As I mentioned earlier, marking the certain records down for destruction and marking the certain dates down for destruction. Third, you can create a questionnaire as part of your inventory. This is desk work that can be done by individuals in a unit, individuals down a branch, etc., where they complete the inventory or survey form on their own. You can pass it out to, you can pass them out to different individuals in your office. These forms tap into the individual's prior knowledge of these records. Now, most common, but probably not the most effective way is because the project is not high on the individual's priority list. They get a questionnaire, they say, I'll fill this out for you, then throw it on the side of their desk, and if it comes like that, they throw it in a pile like a desk a couple slides ago and it never gets filled out for you. So it's best to just get everybody in your office together and say, we're going to have a records management day, and we're going to take a physical inventory of all the records that we have in this office, paper or digital. Now, this is not a project for the faint of heart, but like I said, it's just keep a sense of humor about it, contact us, we'd be more than happy to assist you. Plus, you may learn how information in your office flows, who originates documents, where extra copies can be eliminated. If there's extra copies floating around in certain areas of the office, you can cut down on those, which records are kept longer than they need to be, etc. Now, the main rules of inventory, regardless of whether it's done with a physical inventory, whether it's done via survey, whether it's done via questionnaire, is you need to ask questions until it is clear what the file is, why it is kept, who uses it, and how long it should be kept. Collect only very basic information such as the volume or amount of the records, the owner or custodian of the records, and the location of the records. Now, just to give you an example of what an inventory form looks like, we don't have any set inventory forms we provide to local or state agencies, but this is an example of a good inventory form. See, at the top, we have spaces where you can fill in the office which is responsible for the records. You can fill in the custodian of the records, the location of the records. Additionally, we have sections where you can capture the name by which this group of records is commonly referred. Remember, this is not a folder by folder or document by document of individual items within your inventory. Rather, it is an inventory of those record groupings. Now, you also see a spot where you can put in the description. The description is a brief purpose or function description of these records. Also, you may want to capture information on how they are arranged and the type of files, whether they're subject files, whether they're case files, etc. Now, we also have a column here for media. The media is the format in which the records are maintained. This can be paper, this can be digital, it can be odd formats such as microfilm and microfiche. We also have a column over here for statutory regulations. These are any laws, regulations, requirements, or other mandates for retention. This can include your program schedule or your county or municipal schedule. Now, a great help in using this inventory and filling this inventory form out is to use your county or use your municipal schedule, and that will provide you basically with all the information you need to fill one of these out. So if you go down and you identify certain types of records on a certain standard in your retention schedule, and you say, well, there's 50 different records on here, and we're only dealing with five of them, you can just put those five in the inventory, clean the information from the schedule, and that'll make it a lot easier for you. Now, you have a date range. These are the earliest and the latest dates of the records in question. If the date indicates that these records may be destroyed, then you may destroy the records, and there's a spot on there which you should list that you are able to destroy these records. You should list that on the inventory as well. Now, also, you see the column for confidential and restricted access. Please note essential records. Remember when I talked about essential records? Those records that you need to protect in the event of a disaster, natural or man-made or otherwise. Now, here's an example of another type of, this is just a zoomed in view of the inventory form. Oh, I meant to click on that earlier for you guys. Now, the second step, assessing the situation. Now, use your inventory, the inventory that you've collected, the data that you've collected. Now you put it to your current filing system in writing. Get it down on paper in order to improve it. Now, you sit down with your inventory sheets and your questionnaires. You've got everybody's filled them out. You fill in your inventory, you fill out your questionnaires. Now you need to do an honest assessment of your current state of filing of the records within your office. You don't necessarily have to interpret piles of files as a broken filing system. It may simply be poorly maintained,
may be poorly understood, or people simply lack the time to effectively organize those records. Now, you may determine in the end that your filing system is fine. Your desk doesn't look like a big mountain of trash. So, but your staff may need better training or more resources in order to perfect that, in order to perfect your records management. So you may want to further propose training in your assessment. Now, I'm not sure if some of you may have colleagues that may not have been able to attend today, or you have colleagues that may want to attend some of our training in the future. We are doing local workshops. We have one in Charlotte, and I believe we have a couple in Asheville. So if you have anybody else that needs, or that is interested in records management training, I can send Janina some information on some of those local workshops that we have. Those are going to be going on through to the end of next month. So our Western Regional Archivist, he's actually doing two workshops in Asheville. He's already done one in Franklin. He's doing two more in Asheville, and then we have another one that's going to be in Charlotte. So we're going to walk through a brief, very brief exercise on how to organize and improve your subject filing system. So we have here all these different types of subject files. We can consolidate some of these subject files. So we take all those subject files that have to do with personnel records. So we have absences, accidents and injuries, et cetera, et cetera. But we can even combine some of these into smaller groupings. So you can take some of those personnel files and you can combine them. Oops. Like I said, it doesn't like my interactive slides very much for some reason. So you can take these absences and leave, and you can move them into one particular, you can move them into one subject. You can take position descriptions and application for employment, move them over there. And you can take retirement and Social Security, you can combine them, and you can take United Fund, and you can move that over there into retirement and Social Security as well. So there's all different ways that you can break down your subjects and group them together in order to make it more manageable. Break it down into secondary subjects, tertiary subjects, etc. Now, a couple questions you'll need to ask yourself when you're going through, when you're assessing your records. How often do you need these old records? Are your old records easy to reach? How easy are particular files to find? Doesn't matter if they're paper or whether digital. If somebody can't find them, then they're not doing them very good. And also, how many people need direct access to these files? If the people that need direct access to these files, if they happen to be in another room, perhaps you should consider moving those records that you've identified through the inventory. Maybe you should consider moving those records to that building or making it easier for that individual to gain access to these records. Now, quantify the anecdotal. Those were a couple words that I don't think I knew what either one of them meant before one of my analysts put it in this workshop. But basically, it just tells you to take into consideration other things that you may need to consider when assessing your files. One, space. Can the use of that space be improved, as I mentioned earlier? Are the records convenient to the people who need them? Look for inactive records that are taking up space and which could be moved through off-site storage. Also, if you have files that have confidential information, they will need to be stored in a secure location. Growth. Make projections about how files are growing and how it compares to the available space. So if you have particular files, such as maybe case files, that they're only going to grow over time and they're going to be retained for a long period of time, maybe you need to consider moving those files to a secure location which can better accommodate the potential size of those files before they become unwieldy. Finally, filing equipment. Is there empty equipment that should be removed? Do you need to purchase more filing equipment? These are just some questions you need to ask yourself when assessing the results of your inventory. And it's important to try to be as specific as possible. Now, the recommendations that you can go into any reports that you may, any reports that may result in your inventory. For example, you should put, hey, we need to buy four more filing cabinets to accommodate the use of such and such files. We need to transfer certain files that are inactive but still need to meet their retention requirements, maybe you can transfer them to maybe off-site storage, etc. Now, the third step is make a file plan. File plan is the most important document to a filing system, and I'm almost done here. So, a file plan is a written plan for organizing files. It documents the system that you're going to use, both for case files as well as subject files. A file plan predefines a filing structure so that filing decisions are not made arbitrarily. In addition, a good file plan links to records retention schedules that I talked about and mentioned earlier. Now, with a written file plan, you will be able to understand how your files are organized. You'll be able to understand where an individual file or document should be filed within the larger scheme of files. You can assist users in finding files, other employees. You can tie those files to the retention periods, and you can tie the files to other aspects, such as who's custodian of these files, what the different types of security are for these files, where they're located, etc. Now, making a new file plan. So, sorry if I'm rushing through this, but we have a limited amount of time left, and I want to try and get everything in here for you guys. So,
that's fine.
I'm going to try and finish it up by 11:45. So, that's approximately 3.7 slides per minute until then. So,
Mark,
yes.
Just go ahead. We're going to get this ready.
Okay.
You don't have to
rush. All right. I feel like I'm maybe skipping over some stuff that I'm trying to rush
if we need to, Mark, we'll just quickly grab lunch and you can continue.
I think I have enough time left where I'd be able to get it in at least before 11:50, 11:55.
Okay, perfect.
Because I'm hungry too, I'm going to eat. Just like, I didn't have anything but a Red Bull call right today. The inventory assessment that we talked about earlier is the basis for your file plan. It provides that raw information you need in order to compile that file plan. You need to create an information office IT to take that inventory assessment and then write the resulting file plan. There are certain file plan software packages out there, but they're often done using word processing or spreadsheet software. Now, you need to start with the subject and case filing systems that we created in that step two. Remember what we had, where we had those subjects where we collapsed them in retirement, social security, we collapsed absence being in one particular subject file. This logical scheme will be your article. Range from a general filing to a specific filing. These are predefined subject to category terms like the ones we used and sampled earlier that impose logical order upon files so that they may be filed accurately and retrieved quickly. You'll see a sample file plan in the next slide. Now, remember the subject I'm going to talk about. At the first level, mentioned briefly, the primary level, the secondary level, the tertiary level, or even the tertiary level, I think is the fourth one. These categories and their names should serve the employees. You can put the categories in logical orders on your file plan. The top levels, personnel, information technology, etc., they can be ordered alphabetically or to reflect the latest functions. Now, as we said before, you can break down broad categories into more specific subordinate categories to channel certain pieces of information. Don't be too broad, don't be too specific either. That's a lot of help, right? The goal is a single place for each file. File plans are media independent, i.e. the same file plans used for paper files, electronic files, emails, doesn't matter what format the record is in. File plans should also be in a distributable format. It should be word processing, PDF, a spreadsheet, something on a shared drive. Everyone should be able to have access to this roadmap for the files in your office. Now, you may want to hold training or little workshops on explaining how this file plan works to your staff. The file plan should also be flexible so that it can be adapted as things change and new files and folders can be fitted in as required without changing the overall scheme of the file plan. Now, here's an example of a sample file plan. It uses subjects based on specific business functions, but also includes case file series. Note, it uses common business language. It goes from broad down to narrow. It doesn't quite get too narrow or too specific. It can't have chronological arrangement. These categories encompass all subcategories of that particular subject, and the file plan can be used with electronic or digital files and emails as well. Now, most importantly, consider the arrangement scheme you choose for each series of files. So you want to be able to eliminate duplicates. So if you have several different drafts on here, and you have a final version, once you have completed the final version of a particular draft, you can eliminate all those duplicates of those drafts leading up to that final version. So that way you don't need all these different copies of the draft sitting around on anybody's computer. Now this is just one person's computer. All of these drafts could be available on 10 other people in your office's computer. So once this final draft is completed, you will be able to destroy those drafts leading up to that final draft. So that way you don't have copies of duplicates laying around.
I have a question.
Yes?
A lot of records now, like a
late
switch. Okay. In the county, retention office.
Okay.
Should we be setting that up with the retention schedule for the same employee?
Yes.
A lot of our departments are not.
Yes. Are you with the county or municipality?
Municipality.
Okay. there's a municipal, there's a, if you go to the municipal schedule, do you work in a particular office within the municipal?
Well, no, I work in IT, but
okay,
I actually go over the retention schedules and labor, but
okay.
I can tell you that when I set it up.
So they don't reference the retention schedule when they put the retention periods into that. Okay. So that may be something that you need to tell them. They need to contact one of us at the record center. And if they're not familiar, they may not just be, they simply may not be familiar with the municipal schedule. So they can contact us. We'll speak with them. We'll say we need to reference the retention schedule when setting those retention periods within labor fees. So I'm just going to guess, I think in LaserFish they can put, say, where a document gets flagged after 2 years, that it can be destroyed?
Right. You can, I mean, we've got the retention schedule basically what the city of Bayville has.
Okay.
And so they, I made it very easy for them to kind of choose.
Okay.
Unless there's some other kind of wazoo retention schedule, we kind of keep on searching the forms. But the way that they're setting it up, like, you can have a record series in there, and make your record series, you have your folders and then your documents and things like that. But the record series are there, but they're not set up accordingly. So maybe you just have you guys come down and...
Sure, sure. The information, all of our contact information is on the back page there. You can feel free to contact me initially, and if for whatever reason I'm not available, or I can't go down on a certain day, I can point whoever your contact person there in Fayetteville is to one of my employees, and they'll be able to. We can definitely come down there and set up a time where we can come down there and see you guys.
So once they scan it, they get rid of the paper.
That is something that you will need to send us a request form to do that. There's a process whereby if an office wants to scan records into a system, they have to get our permission before they destroy the original copy of those records. And that form can be found in the form section on the website. It's called a request for disposal of records duplicated by electronic means. Additionally, your office has to have in place an electronic records policy. This lets us know that your office is complying with all the provisions and the guidelines that we set forth as the Department of Natural and Cultural Resources to make sure that you're effectively going to be managing those digital records. Put it bluntly, basically, that they put their money where their mouth is. Yeah, we can effectively manage these records. Here's a document that shows that we can do so. And we'll provide this to you, and by doing so, we're showing that we can comply with your guidelines, and can you please let us destroy these records? So you'll send that form in, we'll comply with it, and send it back to you.
Does that have to come from each department
or in the city? If they have an entire of several different departments under one IT umbrella, and the IT manages all those digital records for all of those departments, you can send that one digital records policy and specify which departments it covers. So that way, if we get a means form in that covers, say, the police department files, we can look on that digital records policy and make sure that that covers the police department. And the police department isn't managed by a separate IT.
And that also
includes HR? HR, you can list HR in the digital records policy. So if the same one manages different departments, you can just list those departments out.
So,
yeah.
So you adopt a record retention policy, and this is basically a separate policy that's covering the electronic records portion.
Yes, the digital records policy is something that says we're going to maintain certain specific records in digital format. We're going to get rid of the paper documents with your approval once this policy is approved. The only thing is you can feel free to scan any records that you want to. You can scan permanent records, but it's important to note that even if you scan permanent records, those records cannot be destroyed. Those permanent records still need to be maintained in perpetuity. So say for example in a human readable format, which means they need to be in paper or they need to be in microfilm. So for example, if you put your minutes, just because you put your minutes up on the website, doesn't mean that your board's minutes, doesn't mean that you can destroy those original copies of those minutes. They need to be sent to us in microfilm, or you need to preserve a paper copy of those minutes. So any other record series that has a finite disposition, which means it says you can destroy it somewhere in the retention schedule, you can scan those records you can scan those records in office and you can destroy those originals. Once you've completed that digital records policy and once you've submitted that electronic means form to us for our permission for us to grant our permission, you destroy those records. server storage. Going back to the file plan, references the retention schedule. The file plan should be media independent, so it can apply to digital files, particularly unstructured digital files, such as those found on shared drives or hard drives. Now, you can note on your file plan where those files are stored. For paper, maybe those files are kept in an office or a file room, but for digital files, they may be on a shared drive. Now, you can include this on the file plan. Also note which one of those is the official document, paper or the electronic version. Sometimes the certain elements of that record may be duplicated electronically, but the main one that you go to is paper. So you need to note on the file plan which one is the official or original record of that particular file. Now, we recommend saving digital files on a shared drive or on a server. Take advantage of IT's protection against emergencies by the use of backups, antivirus, firewalls, etc. If you save it on your local hard drive, rather than on a shared drive, it could be susceptible to being eliminated and not being able to be recovered. So for example, our IT department in our building backs up all the records that we have stored in our shared drive. So they do not back up records that I store on my own personal hard drive on my personal machine. So it's important that if you create any records on your machine, you make sure you move them to a shared drive if you have one. Now, you implement that file plan that we mentioned earlier. You can implement that file plan and integrate it integrate the shared drive onto that file plan. We recommend avoiding using those hierarchies that I mentioned earlier more than four folders deep. This will ensure the digital files are not lost deep in a folder and that there are fewer duplicates. So you don't want to have to click on 20 different little folder icons in order to get what you're looking for. Generally, we recommend no more than four in those situations. It also poses challenges when moving content or upgrading the system. Now, we do have global shared storage guidelines that we have set forth as Department of Natural and Cultural Resources. Those are listed on our website. There's an entire section under that yellow tab for government on our website that is dedicated explicitly to and specifically to digital records. It gives all our guidelines, all our policies on managing digital records, gives some tutorials, and many other helpful documents and instructionals on how to manage those digital records. So this is just the tip of the iceberg what we're talking about here. Now, very briefly, I want to talk about folder labels. Now this is applicable both to paper and to electronic. Folder labels, you don't want, even if it's, like I said, it could be paper or electronic, you don't want to put a label on a folder, whether it's on your computer or whether it's physically storing records. You don't want to put just Forms 1 on there. You want to be able to describe which forms those are. So you want to be able to say that, oh, these are guidelines and policies, these are specifically digitization policies or specifically file format policies. You don't want to, I'm the worst about this on my personal computer in my house, put for Kelly or for Mark or Mark's documents or Mark's fantasy football things, because I don't know which year is in there, and it confuses me every year when I try to start it up again. So, and you need to make sure that you have them specifically named. As far as specific files are concerned, I'm sorry, I'm kind of neglecting this side of the room. I'm walking more to the left side than the right side. But as far as specific file names are concerned, it's important that if it's a particular draft, you want to mark it, rather than just mark it as draft 1, you want to mark it as version 1.0, and you also want to include the date on which that draft was finalized or which date on which that draft was completed. Also, you want to know, obviously, which policy or what the subject filing is of that particular draft. So this way, the hint that we always tell people is you want to be able to know what's in a file without having to click on it. If this draft 1 tells me nothing, I don't know what is going on in this folder and what is going on in this file, so I can just look at this name right here and know that it's the first draft of the social media policy from March 20th, 2012. Now I don't even have to go in there and open it up. So that's important to remember when naming specific individual files. You want to be able to know what's in it without actually clicking on it. Now, it's also important to label your electronic media. You want to be able to notate what department name it is for the records associated or the records stored on that media. You want to file your disks or your hard drives by record series. You don't really want to mix a lot of different types of records or mixed departments records. You have to store them on disks CDs or DVDs. You may also want to put what type of computer is able to access certain files on these disks. Because if somebody has, say, you know, an Apple or Mac, they wouldn't, it'd be more difficult. They may have files which may not be able to be opened on a Mac, as opposed to a device that runs a Windows-based operating system. Same thing, you want to list what the software requirements are for opening the files, including on the disk. And additionally, the dates of the files, and this is very important, it doesn't need to be neglected. Last but not least, the access restrictions. If information on certain disks is confidential, it needs to be noted as such as being confidential. Also, any disks or external drives which have confidential information on them, they need to be treated as just as sensitively as paper documents which contain confidential information. So don't leave them sitting out on your desk. Don't leave them in unlocked file cabinet drawers. They should be locked up just as confidential paper documents and files should be. Now, this is not like my, sorry, I keep saying that, but we do have it doesn't like my interactive workshop for whatever reason. We do have a file naming tutorial or file naming guidelines, and that's on our website. And I'm going to give you the URL here because it's, like I said, it's not showing up on this one. It's www.digitalpreservation.nccdcr.gov/tutorials.html.
Say it again?
That's www.digitalpreservation.nccdcr.gov/tutorials.html. And like I said, our website's having personality crisis for the past year or so. So if for whatever reason this is a dead link, when you try to access it, let us know and we'll get you the new location for these tutorials. Or we'll let you know when these are back up, when the website's back up and running. Because when we're working on it a lot, the website can be down, and it may just be that it's temporarily down. Now, I think this is probably that's another interactive one. So, unfortunately, it's not really working very well on here. I don't know why. Maybe when I copied it over to my external hard drive, it didn't copy over correctly. But in any case, you may need to make sure you don't neglect electronic and digital files on your file plan. You need to also list the best place to store these digital files, whether it's on that shared drive, a local drive, or if you must store it on CDs. You need to list the purpose of these digital files, whether it's for work, collaboration, communication, whether these files are eligible for some type of long-term inactive storage, whether you have on external hard drives or disks. Organization, the folder structure based on your file plan. Retention, which of these particular digital records are most likely to be purged periodically. Also, security. You need to note which records may need to protect, records or folders may need to be protected by password security, specifically targeted by antivirus, ones which specifically need to be backed up, audit trails, and also work with your IT staff to help to assist you in these matters if you don't already work for IT. So. Additionally, if you only have these records stored on a PC or stored on your local drive, look at it, inspect it. We have a lot of guidelines and policies for digital records on our, as I said, mentioned on our website. Sometimes smaller municipalities and smaller counties, it's difficult for them to comply with some of these policies and guidelines that we have. So we do, like I said, we're not the records police. We're not going to specifically punish for anybody for not complying with these to a T. We just ask that if at all possible or to the best of your ability, you comply with the guidelines and policies that we have listed on the website. We can also provide you with some alternatives that may be satisfactory to both parties involved as well. So if you have reservations, if you're looking through the digital part of our website, if you have reservations about whether or not you can do some of the things that we list out in our guidelines and policies, just contact us and we'll be able to work with you and provide alternative solutions. Now, the final step in organizing your paper digital records is to maintain the system. Now, a file plan requires care and feeding, so it is always the authority for your filing and organizing means for your records. The office should have a file plan administrator who keeps that official file plan up to date, distributes any new versions, and manages any training accompanying any specific file plan. Now, there should be a defined procedure and authority to make changes. Not just anybody can go in there and just edit this, edit these file plans. You need to be able to access, you need to be able to contact whoever compiles the file plan or whoever manages the file plan and request changes that way. Only the file plan administrator should be able to change the file plan. Other personnel could make changes at lower levels. I'd recommend the file plan administrator only being responsible for the top two, being responsible for all of them, but only the top two restricted. The top two can be restricted to the file plan administrator. Now, the file plan administrator can also periodically access the file plan, examining the file filing performance and accuracy, whether they need to adjust anything in your office based on the success or failure of certain aspects of it, and affect changes in the business of the office. If there are changes on the retention schedule, making changes to the filing plan as a result of those retention schedule changes, or if we release any new regulations or send out any new policies or procedures. We do use the Nickel G's listserv, so we send out lots of stuff through Nickel G's. Our analysts are, we have a lot of them signed up to the listserv there, so we'll answer questions and we'll send out announcements about workshops, things of that nature through there. So just a couple more tips. I'll try and scoot through these pretty quickly. Rule of five. Now what the rule of five means is, say you have some miscellaneous records and you're not really sure where to place these records within a filing system. What we like to do is we like to create a rule of five folder within a subject heading. So if you have a, let's just say you have retirement and benefits subject heading. And you have a couple different miscellaneous files, you're not sure where to place them within that retirement and benefits section. Well, you can create a rule of five file where you place those files within that rule of five folder, and then once you get five of those same types of files, you make your own folder for those files. So that way you don't have a miscellaneous folder where somebody thinks, oh, this is miscellaneous, I'm going to throw it in here. Then you have 30 different files in there with four or five, you know, copies a piece in there, clogging up, and when the miscellaneous folder ends up being the largest folder in the filing cabinet. I'm sure a lot of y'all have seen that. So that's just very briefly. Does anybody have any questions about that rule of five? That's just something quick that we use, that we recommend people to do if they have trouble with the dreaded miscellaneous folder. Checkout systems. Checkout systems are very important, specifically for paper records. So if you have a filing system and you have lots of paper records stored, and you have a problem with people going in there and pulling these paper records and not returning them, you need to make sure that your office has a policy in place where they need to put in an out card or some type of checkout system in place for these records. So that way you will know when this record was removed, who took that record, and when it was taken. And so that way if you're looking for a specific file and you open a filing cabinet door and you don't see it there, you can go to that person. And you can say, hey, where's this file? I saw that you pulled it on September 9th, 2015. And then they will be able to either provide you with the file or be in trouble because they don't know where it is. So, but it comes very much in handy for us at the Record Center since we store so many agencies' records. Every time we pull a record for a specific agency, we'll put an out card in place of that record. So sometimes we can go up there and somebody requests a record, we'll go up there and we'll pull an out card and say, well, this has been, somebody pulled this in 2009. There are some that are even older than that. So that's why it's important to have that in place, because that way they can't accuse you of saying, well, you lost this record or you did something with this record. And the same thing goes for you guys at the smaller level. Not having to deal with other agencies' records, but dealing with your own records, if you have somebody from another department come in and say, well, what are you guys doing? You're losing my records. If you have an out card or some type of pull system in place, you'll be able to do who, what, when, and where these records are pulled. And the same thing is true with checkout systems on digital records. It's just you can use programs such as SharePoint to aid you in that, to aid you digitally. Now, temporary filing. This is a filing system that can be somewhat confusing to explain, so I'll try to do it really briefly without confusing you guys. Let's just say you have, Well, that one's not interactive anyway, so I'll just skip over that one, because that one's, that one you really need the folders to come up, and because the file's corrupted for whatever reason, they're not coming up. So it's important also that you, I'm going to briefly touch on email while I try and finish up here. You want to have your email organized just as you would all the paper records and all the digital records within your office. So you have over here on the side, you have different types of folders for managing your email. So as soon as, so what I like to do, and sometimes I'm not the best at, is when a particular email comes in, let's just say I get local consultations. If I do a, if I get an inquiry from a local government entity, be it municipality or county, I'll take that particular email and I'll drag it over there as soon as I receive it and put it in one of my folders, put it in the folder designated within my email account for responding to local, municipal, or county inquiries. To give you another example, I have several different state agencies which are assigned to me, have different folders for each one of those agencies. In addition, I have subfolders within those agencies for specific offices within that agency that send me a lot of inquiries, so I break it down that way as well. And I also use the rule of five there too, so if I have an office that sends me, an office, say, in the Department of Revenue that sends me inquiries, once I get five of them, I'll make a new folder for that particular office and I'll make a new subfolder for that office within the Department of Revenue folder. Now, you can also you can manage some of these. You can create rules and alerts if you're using Outlook. Say, for example, I have to, my staff sends me schedule reviews where they help create some of the schedules on a state agency, level. They draft these schedules with the assistance of the state agency. They send it to me where I have to approve these schedules. I can create a rule or alert that any schedule that has request for review in the subject heading be sent specifically to one of the folders within my organizational plan on the previous slide that is specifically reserved for schedule review. And it also creates an alert where it creates a ding or creates a special noise that lets me know that, hey, somebody sent me a schedule for review. I need to go in there and I need to review within the 5 days. So. And there's a bucket of the rules and alerts. Now, the success of any file is in the finding. As I said earlier, if you can't find a file, it's useless. If a file, you know, a file could be the most important file in the world, but if you can't find it, because it's buried deep in a shared drive, you can't find it because it's buried in an unmarked folder or a miscellaneous folder in some filing cabinet somewhere, it's not doing you any good. So the important thing to remember from this is the success of any file is in the finding. Now, for more information, we do have a blog too, and the link to the blog is included in some of the information, included in the links part of the handout that we gave you. If not, it should be on there, the blog is ncrecords.wordpress.com. And it's called the GS-132 files. It's kind of hard to Google because a lot of times you just get GS-132, the law. So you have to specifically say GS-132 files, archives, blog, pull it up. We also have many online tutorials. So feel free to go to the digital records section of our site under the yellow tab and peruse through the various tutorials we have. Not just on digital records, we have a lot. We have some on confidentiality, local governments. We have tutorials on microphone minutes. So various different topics. Now, as I said earlier, as I mentioned numerous times throughout the workshop, this is our contact information. It's replicated on the handouts that I sent you. So if you have any questions at any time about any aspects of records management, digital records, paper records, organizing your records, if you need assistance creating a file plan, if you need assistance doing performing inventory, any clarification of any sort whatsoever, please feel free to call us. I love talking on the phone. It gives me great job security. If I have a 30-minute conversation during that's 1/16 of my day that's gone. So please call and ask us if you have, please call and if you have any questions or need any help or assistance, or email us. Does anyone have any questions? Sorry, I had to rush through that second part. And I apologize for the interactivity not working. The file may have been corrupted when I transferred it over to the external drive, so I apologize for that. But does anybody have any questions on the workshop? Sorry I ran a little bit over, but thank you guys for being patient. Any questions? No questions? All right, well, thank you guys. Good audience, thank you for the questions. A lot of times I just get some audiences to sit there like zombies and doodle, play on the phones the whole time. Y'all seem like you're pretty attentive. You're a great audience. And if you need specific assistance, you can give me a call. I'm not going to be here, but if you get back to Fayetteville, you can call me and leave a voicemail, and I'll be able to get back on Monday. So thank you guys once again. Thank you, Felina, for inviting me. Y'all have a great rest of the day.
Thank you.